Let's pray when we get started. Father God, we thank you tonight just for this opportunity and privilege to come and to study the Word of God. We thank you for the Spirit of God being here to offer us insight and revelation of the Word into our lives. And we just pray, Father, that on tonight, even as we study on spiritual gifts and how they work within the body of Christ, we just pray that you would help us to even fine-tune the gifts that you've given us, to help keep them in the right perspective, that their intent and purpose is not to put the attention on us, but to be able to lift up Jesus with those gifts, so that men might see our good works and give glory to our Father who is in heaven. Father, we thank you tonight. We praise you for everything that you're going to do, and we just give you praise and glory. Yes. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
All right, so we have been sharing with you all the role of the church in the life of the believer, and we've been dealing with spiritual gifts and how your gift works within the body of Christ. And let me say this, that if anybody is truly serious about being involved in ministry, is truly serious about being involved in church, this is a real good opportunity for you to learn what your giftings are. Because I just believe that if you're really serious about it, you should want to know what your giftings and talents are from God, so that you'll know where you fit within the body of Christ. And if you're not willing to take that energy and that time to find out, to take a test that's only 15 minutes long, you know, you're not real serious. Mm-hmm. Come on, amen.
Amen.
Because you know, we will invest time into everything else. But we need to invest time into the things of God so that we can be better, not for ourselves, not to bring attention to ourselves, but so that we can find where we fit in the body and help the body of Christ to be better.
Amen.
Can I get a real good amen?
Amen. Amen.
Come on, amen. So I'm real passionate about that because I'm telling you, I'm just in my spirit, I sense that God wants to do more with us. And I don't mean just, you know, corporately, but even individually, where we can go out into the community and affect people's lives to change the people's lives that we come into contact with. You know, whatever your gift is, it is designed to affect somebody. But if you're not serious about finding out what that gift is and taking the time to understand it, you know, then you're going to miss out on a lot of your life and what God really wants to do. And you could very well find yourself pouring yourself, your energies into things that you're really not gifted for.
That's true.
And I don't know about you, but I really believe time is wrapping up and we ain't got time to be playing no games. We really don't. We got time. We need to get focused. You know, we need to stop living this shotgun kind of life, you know, where we just shooting everywhere. Mm-hmm. But we need to become sharpshooters and rifles and pinpoint what we're going after and be very focused and very purposeful in what we do so that we can accomplish the task and goal that God has for us. I don't know about you, but I really want to get up out of here.
Amen.
Come on.
Me too.
I really do. I look forward to going to heaven. I look forward to the day that Jesus calls us home.
All right, man.
I look forward to his reign. I do. I look forward to it. But I know the only thing that's going to help that process move along is the fact that we got to preach the gospel. Amen. He said, until the gospel goes into all the corners of the world, Jesus ain't coming.
Mm-hmm.
Come on, amen. So we want to make sure the gospel gets preached. All right, so let's talk about these spiritual gifts again. And again, we talked about, well, I think we left off at 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and chapter 13. And so let's go back to 1 Corinthians chapter 12. And we're going to look at these gifts again. And we're going to talk about it. And I know some of you say you took that test and you kind of pinpointed five major gifts that you have. And so I'm going to pick one person tonight. We'll just go through your five gifts and look at what they actually mean and how they function within the body of Christ. But 1 Corinthians, chapter 12. Starting at verse number, let me see, we're going to start at here. Well, let's go down verse 25. It says, verse 25, it says, God's purpose was that the body should not be divided, but rather that all of its parts should feel the same concern for each other. So that means there can't be an atmosphere where we are trying to use God's gifts with self-promotion.
Mm-hmm.
Those two do not go together. Because if whenever there is self-promotion, then that means there is a lack of concern for others. So then the purpose and intent of every gift is for the purpose of building up and edifying the body of Christ. It's never about you.
All right.
Amen.
Amen. It's about how do you fit and how do you affect the body of Christ to make it better. By the gifting that God has given you. Look what he says in verse 26. If one part of the body suffers, all the other parts share in its suffering. Now let me tell you how you know this to be true if this is the mindset of people. When you have people within your congregation that are going through a hard time or suffering, mm-hmm. in whatever form it is, when people will complain about helping them because it's always taking too much to help them, let me tell you something. You really don't, you're not connected like you should be.
All right.
Because if it was you,
say that.
You'd be wanting everybody to help you.
Say that.
Amen? And so we can't, but see, that's a mindset that's not really connected to the whole. Well, I think I'm doing too much. Well, you know what? Or we're doing too much. You know what? That's not our call to make. That's only God can decide that as to what's too much to help anybody.
Mm-hmm.
Right? The body is healed. It belongs to Him, and He can tell it to do what He wants to do.
Amen.
And so, but I said it because that's a good indication to you that if you ever feel like, oh man, you know, we helping people too much. Now, if we just help people, we going broke, not doing what we need to do, and not paying our bills. That's one thing. But when we can help people and it don't affect us at all,
come on,
it's just a speed bump in the road that we keep moving. We ought to thank God that we are in a position,
amen,
where we can minister to those who are in the house.
Yeah, the
amen. How many of you know children require a much more assistance when they're little than they do when they get some. Well, sometimes they get older, they need some assistance. But typically, when children are like my son's age, they can't do a lot of things for themselves financially. So we step in as his parents and we help him and we assist him. Right? We don't think it's too much because we understand the where he is right now in life.
Mm-hmm.
All of us mm-hmm. at some point were babes. And we needed help. We needed assistance.
Amen.
Amen. And if he is suffering, I mean, if you hear parents say this, when their children get sick, I wish I could just take their sickness in their place, don't they? Why? And I feel like that sometimes. When my son, and he's coughing, I'm like, oh, my God. But I have to remind myself, Jesus already did it.
Mm-hmm.
So what I need to do is pray for him and believe God for him. Amen. And whatnot. But he says, when one part of the body is served, all the parts share in his suffering. So listen, someone's suffering should never be seen as your inconvenience. Do I need to say that one more time?
Mm-hmm.
Someone else's suffering should not be seen as your inconvenience.
Mm-hmm.
Should never be. Because we're one body in Christ. So whatever I do to help you to be better, I'm in essence helping myself be better because we're one body.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, no one, if you broke your finger or broke your hand or something, the rest of your body will say, well, see what that's all on you. No, the rest of your body come to his aid, don't it?
Mm-hmm.
It hurt it grips it, everybody goes, the elbow locks up to keep mm-hmm. it safe. And you know, everything your body goes to work to help that part that's been injured.
All right.
Amen. All right, listen. If one part is praised, all the others share in his happiness. Why? Because listen, if a person is being celebrated, they didn't get to that point on their own. There were a lot of people in their life that helped them get to that point.
True.
Amen. So the reason why you should be able to celebrate them and celebrate with them, mm-hmm. because you have played a part in it, even if you just prayed a prayer for them one day,
mm-hmm.
you have played a part in their
amen.
Life
amen.
For them being in that position where they can be honored
amen.
In that way.
Amen.
Amen. You should never be jealous of your pastor for being, but no, he gets a pastor appreciation. Praise the Lord
now.
For that.
Say that.
Your attitude is all wrong.
Mm-hmm.
Because understand that even as a pastor, I can't do all this all by myself. It requires the help of people to do this. And so because at the end of the day, y'all, all the praise, all the glory, and all the honor goes back to Jesus.
Amen.
And the Lord and the Father for what he has done in our
say.
Lives. But you know, the Bible says, give honor to whom honor is due.
Mm-hmm.
Amen.
Mm-hmm.
Or this is, look what he says in verse 27. He said, you are Christ's body, and each of you is an individual part of it. So he brings it all together. We are all part of the body of Christ, and each of us play a part in this body. Mm-hmm. Amen.
Amen.
All right, this is. Now, he says in verse 28, in the church, God has appointed first apostles, and the apostles are the ones who gave us the gospel. You know, they wrote the word based on what the Spirit of God gave them.
Mm-hmm.
The next prophets, third teachers, then those who perform miracles, then those who have the gift of healing, then those who help others, those who are managers, and those who can speak in a number of languages. Not all believers are apostles, are they? Mm-hmm. Are all of them prophets? No. Do all of them teach? Do all of them perform miracles? or have gifts of healing? Can all of them speak in other language or interpret language? You only want the better, listen, you only want the better gifts, but I will show you the best thing to do. See, this is what we miss, because I remember I said that a lot of times we read the Bible in chapters and verses, but it wasn't written in chapters and verses. And I really think ending it there is really does that whole chapter, what we call a chapter, a disservice. Because when he says you only want the better gifts, in other words, most people want gifts that get them attention. They want gifts that puts them in the spotlight.
Feeds their ego.
That feeds their ego. But look what he says here. He said, but I will show you the best thing to do. And then we go into 1 Corinthians chapter 13, which we call what? The love chapter. And he really picks up with these same giftings that he talked about in chapter 12, verse, the end of it. Mm-hmm. He said, look at 1 Corinthians 13:1. He said, I may speak in the language of human and of angels, but if I don't have love, I'm a loud gong or a clashing cymbal. I may have the gift to speak what God has revealed, and I may understand all mysteries and have all knowledge. I may even have enough faith to move mountains, but if I don't have love, I am nothing. So what is he saying? You may have these gifts, but without the love of God, you are still nothing. So then what makes us valuable? Is it the giftings? No. It's our ability to walk in love. That's what makes us valuable in their kingdom. That's what makes God look at us and says, yes, that's my son. Not because you're gifted. And I know a lot of gifted and talented people who have no character.
Amen.
They can sing the paint off wall, but man, they are not faithful people. Come on, amen. I know some people that are wonderful oracles and speakers of the word and can break it down and articulate and, you know, entertain people and all that stuff, but man, they live in shabby lives. What do you think God looks at most? He looks at the lifestyle. And so don't find your value in your gift. Don't find your value in it. You find your value in the fact that you walk in the love of God.
Amen.
Because many people define themselves by their gifts. Many people do. You can't call me nothing but apostle. You can't call me nothing but preacher. You can't, well, hold up. You know, one of the things I personally, now, you know, I think you do that, whatever people do, whatever. But me personally, amongst my covenant brothers who are all pastors, when I see them, I don't expect them to call me Pastor Donald. They my brothers.
All right.
You know, we're just brothers. We all do the same thing. So why would I trip over the fact that they don't call me Pastor Donald?
By the title.
Because people love titles. We live in a society of people that love titles. You know, and I mean, when I see Greg, he's Greg. When Greg sees me, he call me bishop sometimes, but you know, I'm not a bishop, you know. But I'm pastor. But really, sometimes he called me D, called me Donald, he called me whatever, you know. Sometimes I'm his dog, you know. Sometimes that's my dog. You know, but why? Because we're not caught up in the title.
Right.
Because a title means nothing if we're not walking in love.
So is you.
And here's the thing, just because people call you by your title don't mean they respect you.
Say that.
That's true. You know, people, listen, here's the evidence of respect, that people honor you enough that if you're a pastor, they follow your instruction and they do it with a good attitude. That's respect. And they'll call you by your title out of respect, the fact they respect you. And sometimes I do it. Like, for instance, when I was working in corporate America, I would always say yes, ma'am, or yes, sir, to whoever my manager was. Even if my manager was a female and she was 12 years younger than me, I would still say yes, ma'am, to her. And they would love, and one of the girls said, well, why you always say yes, ma'am? I ain't there, though. I said, this has nothing to do with your age. This has to do with me reminding myself of your position. And I said, the reason why I say yes, ma'am, is because it's out of respect for your position, not you.
Right.
It's your position.
Right.
And since your position is one that I am under you, then me saying yes, ma'am, and no, ma'am, to you is me reminding myself to remember my place. And I don't feel insulted by that. Because God tells us to obey those that have the what? Rule over us. So, you know, but we real funny about this stuff. You know, positions and titles and, you know, what people call you and... You know, What about love? What about love? Isn't love, let's keep reading here. In verse 3 he says, I may even give away all that I have and give up my body to be burned. But if I don't have love, none of these things will help me. Mm-hmm. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love isn't jealous. And now think about this. Think about all this in respect to the gifts. So if you have the gift of administration where you like things in order, but even with that gift of administration where you like order, you still have to learn to be patient with people because everybody don't have that same gifting to where they're not going to be as organized as you are. And you must be patient. Listen, you must be kind because you don't want to insult them where they feel like they can't help. Sometimes we act like people in our way. It'd be quicker if I do it by myself. It may be quicker, but it's not best for the whole body. I've met people that say, well, I'll just do it myself. I said, hold up, you can't do everything yourself because then you're not conditioning these people to help.
Amen.
Sometimes you got to slow it down and let people develop. Just because you're there, you can't just take for granted that because you're there, everybody there too. No, sometimes you got to slow things down to let the people catch up to where you are. Mm. But see, the only way you're going to see that is through love. So love is patient, love is kind, listen, love isn't jealous. So I should never be envious of somebody because their gifting gets them a lot of attention.
Say that.
It doesn't sing its own praises. Mm-hmm. It isn't arrogant. Now think about it again. Think about all this in relation to gifts, because this is really what this love chapter is really tied to. It's tied to this about being about the gifts that are operating within the body of Christ. And I believe he interjects love here, and it, like I said, I wish they hadn't broken it up into two chapters because they seem like two separate things. Mm-hmm. But really, when you read 1 Corinthians chapter 13, the love chapter is really tying back to the gifts that exist within the body of Christ and how that love is the balance to all those gifts. Mm-hmm. This is easy. It isn't arrogant. It isn't rude. How many rude people have you met? They can sing the pan on the wall, but when you meet them, they act like they're a superstar. Uh-huh. I'm just trying to say, I like to give. I don't want your autograph. Mm-hmm. We family. Look, little Ray Ray, I don't care how big of a singer he get. When he come home, guess what he is? Mm-hmm. He just little Ray Ray. Anybody want his autograph? Mm-hmm. You just family. That's arrogance kicking in. You thinking more highly of yourself. I don't want your name on a piece of paper. I don't mean that to me. Like that's going to mean something to me. We family. Mm-hmm. Like the world, ain't no big eyes and little U's in Jesus.
Small.
Everybody's necessary. But that's when you start thinking. Now, I'm not saying there are people out there that want that stuff. And I'm not downplaying if people want that stuff. You know, if an author has blessed your life and they have a book out and they're at a book signing and you want them, that's cool. You know, that's fine. But I'm saying when people who are in the position where they are signing their books and they start thinking arrogantly where, oh, you just want to talk to me because you want my signature. Hold up, I don't want your signature. I just appreciate your book. Mm-hmm. I don't need you to even know. I really don't even need you to sign it. I appreciate your book. And it's not like I'm going to run around and say, oh, look, he signed my book. I will probably never say anything about it. It'll go around my shelf. I'll probably pass it on to somebody else. Praise God. All right, this is, but verse 5 says, it isn't rude. It doesn't think about itself. Now think about gifts again. Keep this in the context of gifts. It doesn't think about it. Say, no, I'm not using my gift so you can say how wonderful I am and how great I am. I'm using my gift to benefit the whole. Mm-hmm. Listen, it isn't irritable. How many irritable people we know? Christians, they're very irritable. You ask them, they get irritated with you. Listen, it doesn't keep track of wrongs. It isn't happy. It isn't happy when injustice is done, but it is happy with the truth. Listen, now look at verse 7 says, love never stops being patient. It never stops believing. It never stops hoping. It never gives up. Why do you do all that? What is the motivation of all that? To make others better. If to make others better is not the motivation for why you're using your gift, you're not going to see this working in your life. Listen, love never comes to an end. There's the gift of speaking what God has revealed, but it will no longer be used. There's the gift of speaking in other languages, but it will stop by itself. There is the gift of knowledge, but it will no longer be used. So see, you see how he's tying this to gifts? Mm-hmm. So really, when you take First Corinthians chapter 12, you really need to read chapter 12 with chapter 13 together. Mm-hmm. Because if not, you're going to get out, you go pull things out of context with it. Because he's only tying this back to all the gifts that exist within the body of Christ and how love has to be the thing that is the centerpiece for all those gifts.
All right.
Look at verse 10. Verse 9 says, our knowledge is incomplete and our ability to speak what God has revealed is incomplete. But when what is complete comes, then what is incomplete will no longer be used. When I was a child, I spoke like a child, thought like a child, reasoned like a child. When I became an adult, I no longer used childish ways. Now we see a blurred image in a mirror. Then we will see very clearly. Now my knowledge is incomplete. Then I will have complete knowledge as God has complete knowledge of me. So these three things remain: faith, hope, and love. But the best one of these is what?
Amen.
That's the best one. All the gifts he gave in the body of Christ, the best one is love. Mm-hmm. Why? Because love is the only thing you're going to take into eternity with you. Mm-hmm. You're not going to take faith and you're not going to take hope. Faith will give way to the reality of what you have. Mm-hmm. Hope, which is an expectation, you won't have to expect it anymore because you will have received it when you stepped over into eternity.
Amen.
And the only thing you're going to have in eternity is love.
Praise God.
So if that's the only thing you're taking into eternity with you is love, then everything you do down here need to be motivated by love, so you take all that love when you go.
All right.
Amen.
All right.
Not the giftings. You may not be the best singer. No one may not know your name, but if you sang out of your heart, out of love for God, and it touched somebody to where they wanted a deeper relationship with God, that's all God is asking for.
Amen.
Amen. All right. So we're going to look at some gifts tonight. I know Diana said she had five, so we're going to take your five, Diana, and we're going to go through this definitions and descriptions of these gifts. And so what I would like for the rest of you to do is when you take your test, just write it down on a piece of paper that you can bring to church with you so we can go through that and we can break those gifts down. You may find you have some very similar gifts.
Mm-hmm.
So anyway, let's start with Diana. So Diana, what was your first one?
Administration.
I can see that. Okay, here's what administration is. The Greek word for the spiritual gift of administration is kubernesis. This is a unique term that refers to a shipmaster or captain. The literal meaning is to steer or to rule or govern. It carries the idea of someone who guides and directs a group of people towards a goal or destination. With this gift, the Holy Spirit enables certain Christians to organize, direct, and implement plans to lead others in the various ministries of the church. This gift is closely related to the gift of leadership, but is more goal or task oriented and is also more concerned with details and organization.
Mm-hmm.
Can you see why she's a choir leader?
Because
she's organized. I mean, she's real organized with it. Get it together, get all the paper together for it, get all the songs together. I mean, she's very, you know, times, she's very ordered. So I can see that.
Mm-hmm.
And see, that's why God said that's your choir, that's your praise and worship leader right there.
Mm-hmm.
Does that mean she's better than everybody else? No, it just means for what we need, she's anointed for it.
Amen.
And it requires, listen, to be a leader requires some administration. You cannot have a person who is absolutely chaotic to be an administrator over stuff. Because he can't get stuff done.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Now, you can be, listen, like I'm a pastor. I'm not, administration is not, wasn't even in my top five. It's in there somewhere, because it has to be, and it has to be part of what I do, because mm-hmm. I'm able to do, like, certain aspects of ministry that keep things in order.
Amen.
But that ain't my strongest gift. In fact, it's not even in my top five. So guess what I do? I find people who have an administrative gift.
Amen.
To do certain aspects that I don't want to do. Like, I don't want to do finances.
Mm.
I do it because I have to. But I'm like, you know, but I don't want to do finances. So, shoot, when Miss Evelyn came along, I was like, praise the Lord, mm. Somebody know how to do that. Because then all I can do is just oversee it.
Amen.
But I don't have to try to come up with everything and do everything.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so administration, that's one of them. So that gift of administration has a lot to do with the gift of leadership. It's tied to the gift of leadership, but it is more goal or task oriented. So then think about this gift of administration. It has to be tempered by love. Because if it's not tempered by love, chaotic people go drive dying or nuts.
Come on.
If she has people in the choir that are chaotic, she'll get real tired of them if love is not motivating her. Mm-hmm. And it's easy to do, to just fall straight into your gift without love being a part of it and just get tired of folk. And see, here's the thing. In that frustration, what could very easily happen, it could make her want to quit. If she's relying solely on her gift. Because when she has a gift and people aren't matching that gift, it frustrates you and make you want to quit. That's why love has to be the driving force even behind her using the gift of administration. So that she can be what? Patient, kind, long-suffering sometimes. Why? So that the Spirit of God in that love will help balance that gifting out. This is why I encourage people to develop an intimate relationship with God so that in using their giftings, they are sensitive enough to the Holy Spirit on how to balance that gift out. Because a lot of people lean totally on their gifting without developing their relationship, and they have no character, and they don't know how to deal with people very well. All right, so what's your second one? Yeah.
Faith.
All right, let's look at faith here. What is faith? All right, faith. It says, the spiritual gift of faith is not to be confused with saving faith. Mm-hmm. All Christians have been given saving faith, mm-hmm. as said in Ephesians 2, 8 and 9. But not all receive this special gift of faith. The word for faith in the New Testament is pistis. It carries the notion of confidence, certainty, trust, and assurance in the object of faith. The gift of faith is rooted in one's saving faith in Christ and the trust that comes through a close relationship with the Savior. Those with this gift have a trust and confidence in God that allows them to live boldly for Him and manifest that faith in mighty ways. Mm-hmm. See that in Diana? I mean, when I talked about walking the streets, you were the first one. I do it! Because mm-hmm. you have faith for it. Mm-hmm. Most people, you talk about It's intimidating to them.
Yes.
It's intimidating. You know, I'm going to talk with strangers. Uh-huh. It's intimidating. Her, she's like, oh, I do. Yeah, I do. Rain, sleet, or snow, down, I'm ready to go.
Say that.
You know, I mean, that's it. And that's just, but I see that. Now, look what it says here. In the Bible, the gift of faith is often accompanied by great works of faith. In Acts 3, 1 to 10, we see this gift in action when Peter sees a lame man at the beautiful gate and calls on him to stand up and walk in the name of Jesus. Jesus said even a small amount of this faith could move mountains. Mm. Listen, the Holy Spirit distributes this gift to some in the church to encourage and build up the church in her confidence in God. Those with the gift of faith trust that God is sovereign and He is good. Mm-hmm. They take Him at His word and put the full weight of their lives in His hands. They expect God to move and are not surprised when He answers a prayer or performs a miracle. In fact, they usually more surprised when He don't.
Yeah.
Like, what's going on? What happened? Why? Because that gift of faith is there. Now think about this. How does faith work? Mm-hmm. Faith works by love. So usually, if you find a person with a gift of faith, you're going to find a person with a deeper level of love, too. Because faith works by love. Mm-hmm. You know? Come on now. Amen. And I see that in Diane. I can see that. I see that with, like, just by her testimony today about Michelle and leading Michelle's mm-hmm. daughter to the Lord today. Mm-hmm. That is an evidence of faith. Because, you know, again, that's in mind. But see, here's the thing. Think about faith. Sometimes it pinpoints specific areas. Like my faith, I can believe God for some finances. I can believe God for stuff to get done. Mm-hmm. You know? But there are other areas of my faith where it's not that strong. But so your area, but think about this. So you may have five people in your company with a gift of faith, but one might have faith for believing God for buildings, one might have faith to believe God for finances, mm-hmm. one might have faith to believe God for the church to grow, mm-hmm. one might have faith to be on the streets. But all of it's the gift of faith. It's just operating in different aspects and different areas within the ministry.
Amen.
So that's why I said it's good to do the test, because now when you think about where's Diana's probably gift of faith at? It's with people. She has a faith for people. Mm-hmm. To listen, real faith don't just I believe God, but real faith get involved with people and do stuff. It's always volunteer. Diana always volunteer with stuff. You need me to do something, Pastor? You need me to grocery shop for you? You need me? Just that faith, that active part of faith in her to believe God, to be effective in the body of Christ. And it takes faith to be a praise and worship leader.
Most does.
People can be flaky sometimes. I mean, it can. People can be flaky in that. But if you don't have a strong praise and worship leader, when people go start messing up, they quit. Because like this is just too much for effort. These people don't want to do this. Person of faith, I'll do it myself. If I need to do it, I'll do it by myself. All right, praise the Lord. All right, so can you see that in your life? That gift of faith, amen. So she got administration, which I see that. I see faith, I see that. See, I'm telling you, that's why I said get yours. Each of you get yours, because I'm telling you, it's going to be amazing to you when you go through it. You say, man, I see that. I see that in my life. All right, what's your other one, Diane?
Healing.
All right. The spiritual gift of healing found in 1 Corinthians 12:9 is actually plural in the Greek. Charismato, eumaton, is literally translated gifts of healing. This spiritual gift is closely related to the gifts of faith and miracles. Mm-hmm. Isn't that amazing? Mm-hmm. All spiritual gifts are to be exercised in faith, but the gifts of healings involve a special measure. This gift is interesting in that there is no guarantee that a person will always be able to heal anyone he or she desires. Mm-hmm. It is subject to the sovereign will of God, as all spiritual gifts are.
Amen.
But here's the thing. If she has a gift of healing and faith attached to it, mm-hmm. here's what she will have. She will have the boldness to pray for anybody. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I see that in her. I see that in her. She'll pray for anybody. It don't matter. She'll pray for you. Homeless on the side, she'll pray. Dying, go pray for you. Mm-hmm. Listen, the disciples were given authority to heal and to cast out demons, but they were not always successful. The Apostle Paul was not able to heal himself and was told that, I don't agree with that one. This gift is given at various times and places to reveal the God of heaven to the sick and tormented. If healing is not granted, then we conclude that God has greater plans for letting the person. No. Mark that out. Okay, the spiritual gift of healing is an intimate one as it reveals the heart and compassion of God. Jesus is the great healer and physician, and during his ministry on earth, he healed countless people and cast out demons. Healings reveal that God is near to his people and he cares about their suffering. Healings are meant to draw people to God through his son, Jesus Christ. Amen. God wants those healed to respond in faith with thanksgiving and love, as the leper did in Luke 17, verses 15 through 19, and as the demon-possessed man did in Mark 5, verse 18 through 20. By God's grace, physical healing should lead to spiritual healing, faith in Jesus, and eternal life with him in heaven. Those who have this gift are compassionate towards the sick and pray over them regularly. They have great faith and trust that God can and will heal some and are not deterred when he chooses not to. Now, I don't think that's necessarily up to God. I think as far as healing goes, it's not because once God makes something available to us, it's up to us to ask whether or not we're going to receive it.
Amen.
And here's why I say, never let other people be the determining factor as to whether or not God will heal.
Come on.
Because you don't know what's going on in a person's heart.
Amen.
You don't know what's going on in a person's head.
Amen.
I have prayed for many people, and upon praying for them and believing God for them, I knew in my spirit that they really didn't believe. Even though they said they did, I knew in my spirit they really didn't believe. I knew it. Just sensed it. There are sometimes when I'm praying for people and I lay hands on something for healing, I can feel it coming right back. And I know faith isn't there for them. They're like, well, they worried. And you know, I'm praying for healing and deliverance and all that, and they're still thinking about the doctor. But here's why that gift of healing, it goes along with faith too. Because in that gift of healing and tied to faith, faith will not allow you to be deterred simply because someone dies that you prayed for.
Say it.
And see, that's why I said you got to be real careful, because in dealing with healing, like I don't agree with some of this. Like Paul, when Paul, when Paul said, I had the thorn in the flesh and I besought the Lord three times to remove the thorn, and God says, no, my grace is sufficient for you, for in your weakness my strength is made perfect. Mm-hmm. There's no record of that, that was sickness. And secondly, the reason why I don't believe it was sickness, because the question then becomes, can God say no to something that he said yes to in Jesus?
Say it.
That means Jesus and God are at odds with one another.
Which is impossible.
The Bible says, Jesus was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquity. Now, was he physically bruised?
Oh, goodness.
Amen. So that means if he was physically bruised, that means physical healing had to come to us. Mm-hmm. The complete opposite of that. Was he spiritually bruised? Absolutely. So we could be what? Spiritually whole. And so it says that through his stripes, that by his stripes, we were healed. See, people say, well, he's just talking spiritually there. No. Mm-hmm. The Bible doesn't specify. When the Bible doesn't specify a specific area, you take it for all of it.
It's literal.
Yeah, it's literal, for both, spiritual and physical. Mm-hmm. The Bible says, and 2 Peter says, God has given us everything that pertains to life and godliness. That means anything I need for the physical living and anything I need spiritually, God has already provided it. Mm-hmm. The Bible says in the four Gospels that according to your faith, be it unto you. He says, if thou canst believe, all things are, what does all mean? All things are possible to him that believes. But then he says this, and if you have ought to forgive, so that your Father in heaven can forgive you. So there's a lot of issues going. Listen, there's a lot of issues going on in people's life that people aren't honest about.
Amen.
Like people harbor unforgiveness. People harbor doubt. They don't say anything about it. They bury it and try to act like they in faith, which then just becomes religion. And religion will never get you healed. It'll never get you whole. So I will always pray for people and believe God for people. But at the end of the day, what are they believing?
Amen.
Because people can say, we all have people say one thing and do another.
Lord.
And so, but a person who has the gift of healing, they are never deterred because someone they pray and they don't get it. I pray for many people that didn't get better.
But you're standing on the ground.
That didn't deter my faith at all.
You're standing on the word,
yeah,
and not someone else's feeling about the
exactly
word. Okay.
So you don't buy that. You don't get deterred because you pray for people that don't get healed. So now remember this: the Bible says that when Jesus went down to his hometown, he said the Bible says he could do no mighty miracles except lay his hands on a few sick folk and see them healed. Why? Because of their what?
Unbelief.
So then, how did he combat unbelief? So what, the next thing you read, and Jesus went about teaching the gospel, teaching the word to them. Why? Because faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So every time, listen, some people have squandered the word to where they have not developed their faith to believe for certain things. And so because they squandered it, now all of a sudden a big problem come up, and they now want God to do something. And what God sometimes says, wait a minute, I gave you 5 years to increase your faith, and you have not taken advantage of what I presented to you. Now all of a sudden you want me to step in and fix it for you. He said, well, because the way I did fix it was I put you in a position where you could hear the real word to believe, and you just dismissed it.
Amen.
So now that you need it, now you can't get it. You can't get your faith up to believe for it. So that's why I said, so whenever you have a gift of healing and praying for people, that don't deter. That won't deter them because you don't get healed.
Mm-hmm.
And don't let it ever deter you from praying for people. Or it looks too hard.
No.
It's not too hard for God. But sometimes it's not about what you believe, it's about what they believe. And I would dare say most of the time it's about what they believe. Every now and then you see Jesus heal people based on his own faith. And then sometimes he healed people based on their faith. Like the woman who had the issue of blood. She came up and she, but the thing about her mind was one of already that was set on healing.
Amen.
If I could but touch the hem of it, I don't even need to touch him. I just need to get a hem. If I can get a hem, praise God, I'm going to be healed.
Made whole.
And she snuck in and she just touched the hem and she got healed. And Jesus stopped and said, who touched me? He said, I feel virtue go from me. Everybody's touching you, Jesus. No. He said, all these touches are touches of desperation. But I feel a touch of faith. And when faith touched him, it pulled out of him the power to heal.
Amen.
It wasn't even up to Jesus. It was up. She took it. Because her faith believed for it, and she got it. And the Bible said, but think about it. She tried everything else and spent all her money on doctors and natural means. People always try to go to the natural means, and when the natural means run out, well, I guess I gotta try God. Yeah, I guess, okay, you wasted everything else. But what if we would learn to hold on to the stuff you got and just go to God first?
Amen.
And not waste everything.
Amen.
See, sometimes, let me tell you something about the grace of God. Sometimes the grace of God will put you in a church where they teach it to you. About how to believe God. That's why I thank God for Pastor Gow. He taught me how to live by faith.
Mm-hmm.
So when trouble came, when trouble rose up in my life, I didn't even think about Pastor Gow. I thought about what he taught me. I gotta call Pastor. I gotta call him. Call him up. I didn't call Pastor. When John came early, 2 pounds, 7 ounces. Oh, his heartbeat is slowing down. We gotta take it. Mm-hmm. I'm like, oh, y'all do what y'all gotta do. I'm good. I had the peace of God. I was sitting there this chilling. I felt so peaceful. And the nurse said, Mr. Manning, you're so calm. I said, ma'am, I got a promise.
Amen.
I'm good. Do whatever you got to do. At the end of the day, my boy should live.
Mm-hmm.
And not just live, but he will thrive. But see, I had to follow the instructions of God. When he was sitting there, little incubated, 2 pounds, 7 ounces, little itty bitty thing. Man, I'm telling you, I would be preaching somewhere. And man, the anointing of God would fall, and I would just feel the presence of God. And God was in now. He said, go up there. He said, don't touch anybody. Lay hands on your son.
Mm-hmm.
And I would leave that service, not talk to people. I thought I was rude. But I would, after right preach, walk right out the door, get in my car, drive right up to the hospital, find my little boy, put my hand in the name of Jesus. I said, I declare he should be whole and healthy. They kept saying, oh, well, you know, preemies have all these problems. They have eye problems. They have ear problems. They have this and this and that. I said, I don't receive any of that for my son. He shall be whole and healthy and healed. And I'm telling you, man, God honored. Praise
Amen.
God.
Amen.
Listen, in fact, she said, one of the nurses told me, he said, he was such a miracle. She said, most preemies at some point, because they have to monitor them constantly. She said their heart will stop. She said, it'll start, but it'll stop and start and stop because they're preemies and they're struggling to live and to dysfunction. She said, but your son, she said, not one time did his heart ever stop the whole time he was in here. She said, not one time did it ever flutter.
Mm-hmm.
Why? Because he had a daddy, praise God, that had a promise from God and that had the audacity to believe what God said about my boy.
All right.
Praise God.
All right.
That's faith.
Amen.
That's an act of faith. Now, in a natural sense, you know, people say, how you handle that? I believe God.
Mm-hmm.
Praise God.
Amen.
That's what healing does. It's not deterred by what other people say and what everybody is saying and what it looks like. No, we believe God. I see my son through faith.
Mm-hmm.
And faith comes from the revealed word of God. The revealed word of God that said I would have a son and he would be greater than me.
All right.
Praise God.
All right.
I'm passionate about it. Praise God. I am. Because I want people to get it. But if you don't take time to find out what your gift is, you'll never develop it. You really could be a master musician, but you're too afraid to pick up a guitar and find out. You could be gifted to speak the word of God, but you're too afraid to step beyond those boundaries and stand up in front of people and talk.
Amen.
But you could be, come on, I was the most shyest kid in the world. Had low self-esteem, always looked at the ground, couldn't make eye contact with people. But didn't learn how to speak until I was much older. I had a speech impediment, had to get, here I was at like 7, having a tutor to learn how to talk.
Wow.
Come on, amen.
Know.
And God took all of that, praise God, and wrapped it up and called me a preacher.
Mm-hmm.
And said, teach my word to my people. The one who couldn't talk, the one that everybody looked at and said, I don't know what he going to do with his life. Come on, amen.
A part of being a new creature.
Come
Christ.
On, hallelujah. All right, Dan, what's your other gift? I'm going to keep you.
Hospitality.
Yep, okay, hospitality.
That's true.
Is that on this one? Let me see. That was not even on this one. But I know what hospitality is. They are people who love to entertain. They are very oriented towards making people feel at home.
Amen.
They're very oriented towards making people feel welcome. They're the type of people that don't mind having people over to their house. They ain't scared about them messing up something.
Come on.
Well, they spill the Kool-Aid on my brand new carpet. They're not like that. They're like, oh, who cares? I'm having the opportunity to minister to people.
Mm-hmm.
That's hospitality. They're very hospitable people.
Mm-hmm.
They are very much people person. Let me tell you, a pastor has to be hospitable.
Sure.
I've met many pastors that did not like people. You in the wrong profession, bro. You don't like people. Not comfortable with people. No, hold up. One of the things that God says that we have to be is we have to be hospitable. If anybody going to be hospitable in the body, it better be that shepherd. Sure. Has to be hospitable. You have to like people. People can't be an inconvenience to you. Amen. And people that are hospitable don't mind inconveniencing themselves to be a blessing to other people. Come on, amen.
Mm-hmm. Pastor should have a character about him.
Yeah.
But I would say, you know, and then there's some people it's awful hard to like, but you have to have a genuine love for them.
Because what make all these gifts work?
Love the driving force. It's the love tempers all the other gifts.
Yeah, I like standing around after service and talking to everybody and, you know, saying hi and playing with the kids. And I love that stuff. Mm-hmm. That's just me. You know, I'm ready to go. I ain't ready to go. I got people to talk to. I like talking to people. I mean, I thrive. When you put me with people, I thrive. You know, I'm not the kind of person to walk in the room like, oh, no. No, I do put me in a room with people I don't know. Oh, I find somebody to talk to. I just like people. Amen. So what's your other one, Diane?
Last one, serving ministry.
Mm-hmm. Serving ministry. Let me see what it says. Serving in ministry. Here it is. The spiritual gift of service or ministering covers a wide range of activities in its application. There are two Greek words for this gift. The first one, found in Romans 12:7, is diakonia. The basic meaning of this word is to wait tables. But it is most often translated in the Bible as ministry. It refers to an act of service done in genuine love for the edification of the community. The word antilipius is translated helping and is found in 1 Corinthians 12:28. It has a similar meaning to help or aid in love within the community. That's why she can do street stuff, because she has a heart for it.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what you have to find are people who have these. This is why I want to know everybody's giftings, because whatever your gifting is, that's why I need to start trying to put you, rather than just trying to guess all the time. That's why I want everybody to take this spiritual gift test, so I can find out where you are, and so you can find out where you are and why you are geared towards certain things. Amen. Listen, the Holy Spirit endows some believers with this gift to fill the many gaps of ministry and meet the needs of the church as it fulfills the Great Commission. In other words, you're going to have, when you're growing a ministry, you're going to have a lot of gaps and stuff, or things that need to be done. But people that have a heart to serve and minister, they may not necessarily be anointed for certain things, but because they have this heart, they can fill in that gap for a short period of time.
Amen.
Until the right person comes along and can step into that position and in their place.
Amen.
So you need the serving people. You gotta have them. Because like I said, there's a lot of things I did, like at Webster, even at Faith of the Victory, that I wasn't necessarily anointed for, but I did it simply because there was a need that needed to be met. And so I filled in the need. You know, I mean, people go, I gotta go pray about it. You ain't gotta pray about it. You see a need and you know it's a need. You know, well, I see paper on the floor. I need to pray about picking it up. No, you don't need to pray about it. Pick the paper up.
Come on, amen.
Well, I see some trash on the floor. I need to pray about when I need it. Get the vacuum cleaner, just run it on over and pick it up. Come on, amen.
Amen.
You ain't gotta pray about it. That's just an excuse to not do something.
Exactly.
You know, if you see, you walk by the paper, well, you know, get somebody to pick this paper up. You just noticed it, pick it up.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. We see people with this gift in passages like Acts 6:1-7, 1 Corinthians 16:5-15-16, and many others. Those with the gift of service are committed to spread of the gospel. They serve in ways that benefit others with different gifts and ministers that are more public, which is very true.
Mm.
People who are anointed to just serve like this, serving and ministering like this, they don't mind working with under people. They don't mind following instructions. They don't mind you telling them, you know, I need you to do it this way. Because they have a heart geared towards service, which is motivated by love, they are very flexible people. It don't have to be, you know, some people, they so stiff, you know, they get one thing, they want to do that one way for the rest of their lives.
Mm-hmm.
And if you change it on, they lose their minds. They don't know that. Don't, why are you doing it like that? Hold up, ain't that serious? You know? We just changed the service from 11 to 11:30. Oh, why are you doing that? You know, they don't have no change for them, because they really don't have a heart to serve like this. All right, listen to this. Is it those with this gift do not seek recognition or a position in the spotlight? They just love to help out. There are people like that. They just love, and you listen, you need a lot of those people.
Oh, Lord.
You really do. You need people that just love to help. It's called the ministry of helps. They just love to help. Just whatever you need me to do, I do it. What do you need me to do? I do it. You need what? I do it. They just like to help. Amen. Now, I mean, this gift, I probably served in a lot in this gift when I was at Faith is a Victory. I just like to help. Whatever you want me to do. Mm-hmm. I was always looking for an opportunity just to help. Now, do I flow in it as much now? No, because my position has changed. Mm-hmm. Remember I said about your gift, they will change over years. You know, in fact, you take this next year, you'll probably see certain gifts have risen more so than other gifts.
Mm-hmm.
Some gifts you'll find will decline, but is it based on the need within the body?
Amen.
So the Lord, listen, the Bible says it is God that worketh in you both to will and to do of his good pleasure, which is desire and ability. He will change your desires to meet the needs within the body.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So there are some things you might do for a season, you may be really good, you might get tired of it, and God said, I need to move you over here. And he'll move you over there. And then that gift will start developing, and then you take the test again, you'll find that your gift has completely changed from what it used to be. Why? Because the needs within the body change. And then the Bible says Jesus can put us wherever he sees the need.
Amen.
He can fit us somewhere else. So don't ever get so locked into what you do that you think that's what you go do for the rest of your life.
Come on.
That may not be the case.
Come on.
Listen to this. They are content with serving in the background, knowing that their contribution will bless the church, display the love of Christ to the world, and bring glory to God. That's the serving, ministering people. They do. They're the ministry of help. They like to help. And they great gap. You know, they're kind of like, what's that blood type that goes with anything?
O negative.
They're like O negative in the body of Christ. They are. They really. They're like O negative. They just fit wherever. They work with whatever. They just put them wherever they just fit. They're like O negative people. They just go. Well, if you put them there, they'll conform to whatever they need to do, because they just want to serve. And they didn't want to help people. They don't need the spot. They don't need no recognition. They don't like recognition. They're not really comfortable with it. They just kind of want to stay in their little thing. Let me help out behind the scenes. They behind the curtain people. They cool being behind the curtain. Mm-hmm. They don't feel no pressure to get out from behind the curtain. You know what? They might spend years like this. But one day, like Joel Osteen, he was a behind the curtain person. Just loved mm-hmm. serving his daddy. Loved picking out his suits for TV, making sure he matched the screen. He did that for years. Loved him. But one day God said, it's time for you to come out from behind this curtain, mm-hmm. and I need to bring you to the spot. I don't want to go to the spotlight. I like being behind the curtain. I just want to serve my daddy. You know, I'm good back here behind the curtain. Because it's time for you to come out to the forefront.
Mm-hmm.
And look what happened to him.
Mm-hmm.
Brought that boy to the forefront. He took that minute to a whole nother level that his daddy never could. But he served quietly. I didn't even hear, that was a Joel Osteen.
Mm.
But God had that boy hidden behind the scenes, serving his father faithfully. And then God, one day, just after all those years of service, brought him to the forefront.
Mm.
And God, listen, and God, if you really learn how to operate your gift out of the spirit of love, I'm telling you, God will bless your life like never before. And it's not about money. It's not about recognition. It's not about the acknowledgement of men. It's when the Father acknowledges you
mm-hmm.
and says, this is my beloved child in whom I am well pleased. Mm-hmm. That's what it's about, y'all. Amen?
Amen?
Praise God. Okay, well, we'll stop right there, and we'll pick up next week. But I pray this bless you. Again, I want you guys, and if you're listening to this via YouTube, you're listening to this via conference call, take that spiritual gift test. And bring that in, but I want to go through those gift things with you so that I can help you identify where you fit. Amen? Praise God. All right, let's pray. We'll let you go. Thank you all for being here. Father God, we thank you for this tonight, Lord, and we just pray that even as we learn and discover our giftings and talents that you've given us, Father, we thank you for your people having a heart and a passion to go after this, that they might understand what you are calling them to do and finding out where they actually fit within the body of Christ. We praise you, Father God, for this. We thank you tonight for safe travels home, that each of us will arrive at our destination safely without incident. And we just thank you that we are covered under the blood of Jesus.
Oh,
we love you, Father. We thank you that you are doing exceedingly abundantly above all that we can imagine and think, according to the power that worketh within us. And we praise you for everything you're doing. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen.